Namaste, everybody, and welcome to Sangam Talks. So the topic is the Aryan debate, getting serious about it. It's time we got serious because now you can see people like Romila Thapar and all that rearing their heads again. And so naturally, you need to get this also as a the facts out there in the mainstream for the benefit of the people. So a brief of this talk. So the Vedas, they do contain historical data, and this was acknowledged by everybody, but interpreted within an invasionist framework, unfortunately. So recent and very detailed reinterpretation by Shrikant Talageri ji describing middle and late phases of the Aryan emigration from India. It's his factual, you know, full kind of a summary of this and research has still remained unanswered from that side who supports the Aryan migration or Aryan invasion theory. And also, unfortunately, his research and scholarship remains largely unknown, even amongst the general public. So Indian announcements refutating the Aryan invasion theory, unfortunately, have remained in their echo chambers and not made a dent also in the international consensus. Very unfortunate, and we are trying to remove that. We need all your support. And with emerging acceptance by Indo-Europeanists that their much-touted Yamnaya homeland in Ukraine and Russia is only a secondary homeland. They have accepted this. The time is ripe now for a breakthrough in the Aryan debate by our side. So our speaker today, Shrikant Gangadhar Talageri ji, he's a BCom, D.Litt honors, and he has written four major books from 1993. Right till 2019 on the Aryan problem or the Aryan invasion theory versus the out of India theory debate. And after Shrikant ji's presentation, we'll have the very famous Dr. Koenraad Elst also joining in. He's a Belgian Indologist with a master's in Indology, Sinology and Philosophy and author of major books on the AIT versus the OIT debate.
Getting serious. The thing is, we who are doing research in this have been serious all these years. And actually, the fact is that the OIT has been completely established and the AIT has been completely demolished. But when you see the circumstances around you, it seems the opposite. So what we have to be serious about now is to put forward the OIT case in such a way that people come to how to acknowledge it. And how can you do that? I mean, as I always say, we cannot mesmerize people that from now on, you will believe in this OIT and not believe in the AIT. The only thing that can happen is when there is a debate. Because we have shown that the OIT completely answers all the linguistic, archaeological and textual aspects. Whereas the AIT is demolished in all those fields. And genetics also, the measly and flimsy evidence that they put forward, the argument, they have also been completely demolished again and again. So the point is that as long as they don't acknowledge it and they hold all the reins of media, academic and other power, then we are just banging our head against the wall. The only way in which we can move forward, and you know, whenever any new thing comes forward, new evidence for us, for the OIT, we present it. I have been constantly writing blogs, bringing up new points. Then when someone raises some objection to what we have already written, then also I write blogs and, you know, answer them fully. If they have actually managed to point out some fault of mine, I correct it and thank them for it. But if their arguments are, objections are wrong, I show why they are wrong. And so we can keep on presenting and correcting ourselves. And the AIT people just don't respond. So we can keep on doing our work. But until there is a debate, you know, people will still keep saying they are the victors because they just run away from the debate. So the only thing we have to get serious about is having a debate. Because we can answer all their points. They can't answer any of our points. Like some of the points that I'll be presenting today, linguistic points and all. They're unanswerable and they're facts. They're not, you know, my subjective opinions or just guesswork or just believe it on faith. It's not like that. They're facts which no one can deny. and even the implications of those facts are so clear that no one can really point out factually. They can just say, oh, I don't want to believe you. You're just a bank employee. You're not a professor, or no international journal, which are all controlled by those people. So why will they publish our articles? So in fact, they should publish articles taking our theses and our evidence and arguments and disproving it. But they're not doing that. So that is the major problem. I mean, we are serious. It depends on when the debate becomes serious. So what I will do today is point out some of the impediments. Of course, the opposition people are the main impediment, the AIT supporters and others, and the anti-Hindu elements who treat this as a Hindu issue. And they feel that those who are talking about against the Aryan invasion theory are basically Hindu-minded. I am Hindu-minded. I will not deny it. But if you read many of my blogs, I criticize and condemn even things which Hindus would consider very sacred. Because wherever criticism has to be done, I do it. So it is not a question of that. So what is required now is just a debate. And so I will be pointing out first, what is it, apart from those direct open enemies, what are the other things which are constraining us? And secondly, then I will just give a short summary of the archaeological and linguistic evidence, which no one has been able to refute. And the first thing we have to do is that people on our own side refuse to accept that there is an issue. They say, oh, Aryan invasion theory has been already disproved. And so there's nothing to discuss. So they, once you say that, then everything is at an end. So I think I'll present that PowerPoint. See, this whole debate has landed in an impasse because people on our own side refuse to consider the out of India theory. They think that there is an Aryan invasion theory. Let us disprove it. But they don't realize that you cannot disprove it until you present an out of India theory against it. And all the scholars are concentrating on disproving the Aryan invasion theory. Now, this battle between the Aryan invasion theory and the anti-AIT people without the OIT has landed in an impasse because both of them are governed by certain intransigent attitudes. For example, the supporters of the theory insist that their theory is final and refuse to examine, as I said, they refuse to enter into a debate. They simply say, you are this, you are that. They call our politics, our academic status, and other silly things like that. And the other, from our side, there are people who say, there is no case at all. Why waste time on something which does not exist? Or no sense in flogging a dead horse. You know, this particular phrase was there in a comment immediately when Koenraad Elst announced on Twitter that this program was going to take place. In a sense, it is true, it is a dead horse, but actually it is also a living horse until people acknowledge that it is dead. So that is what the problem is all about. And the main problem is, why is it? Because the anti-Aryan invasion theory side, that is the Hindu side, let us say in short, they think that only by showing that the Rig Veda goes back to beyond 2000 BC, because, you know, according to the theory, the Aryans entered India after 2000 BC. So just by showing, taking the dates back. And secondly, by showing that the Vedic people are identical with the Harappan people or connected with them and not different from them. And so their roots go back deep into the soil. Just by these two methods, they think that without resorting to an out of India theory, the Aryan invasion theory automatically stands disproved. Now, there are two groups among them. The first group is only concerned with showing that, you know, these people said Aryans were nomads. They started by saying that Aryans came and civilized India. But once the Harappan civilization was discovered, they changed it. They said the Aryan invaders were nomads. And the local people had a very high civilization, which was destroyed by the invading Aryans. So this particular group of people, Hindus, they are only concerned that our Vedic culture is being considered a nomadic, primitive sort of culture. And they want to connect it with the Harappan period. They have no objection to the Aryan invasion theory as such. So they are willing to say Aryans may have come to India, but that was before the Harappan period. The Harappan people were Aryans. Before that, they may have come from outside. So they are indifferent to this debate. The second group totally neglects the idea of Aryan immigration. And this is the crucial point. They don't realize that this whole thing is not about architectural, archaeological sites, or about what books say, or about genetics and things. It is about language. It is only about language, which is why it is a purely linguistic issue. Before the linguists brought up this Aryan theory, no one had even suspected all this. But these Hindus reject the idea. They say, how can you say that some Indian languages of North India are related to European languages, but not related to the languages of South India? That is the way they look at it. Now, this is a very weird way of looking, because see, now if the people in Guyana, you know, in South America, there are so many Hindus who left, who were taken there 200 years ago or whatever, and they have now stayed there for generations and generations. And many of them went from UP and Bihar. So when we examine their history, we will say they went from UP and Bihar. So obviously they are very close to the people of UP and Bihar. Then suppose some nationalist says, you mean to say that UP Bihar people are closer to these Guyana people than they are to people from Maharashtra? That is against our national unity, which is very foolish, because see, it is a fact that they went from UP Bihar. Now, if you have some relatives staying in America since generations, they will still be your relatives. You are still connected with them by blood. It doesn't mean you are cut off from other Indians who are still living in India. But that is the foolish way in which people oppose this. They want to say that there is no distinction between Aryan and Dravidian languages, because then automatically they feel that it divides India, which is a wrong. So what I want to first say is that you should recognize that there is such a thing as an Aryan or Indo-European language family, which is distinct from the Dravidian languages of the South, or the Austric languages of certain eastern states like Odisha, Jharkhand, etc. So today, first I will concentrate on this, because if you don't know what you are arguing about, there is no sense in arguing. What we are arguing about is the Indo-European languages, not about people, not about genes and DNA. About these languages, whether they came to India or they went out from India. That is the discussion. So let us realize that there is such a thing as an Indo-European language family. And we are discussing the history of that language family. Now, the fact is that there are 12 groups, branches of Indo-European languages spread out from India to all the way to Western Europe. And of course, in colonial times, they have spread out all over the world, so that the Americas, Australia, and everything, now they are also Indo-European language speaking. But basically, it is from India to Western Europe. Now, all these languages are related to each other. That is the first fact. Second fact is that if they are related to each other and they are spread out over such a big area, originally they must have been close together to each other in one particular area. So the whole question is, which is that area? So that is what the discussion is about. So first, let us recognize whether there is an Indo-European language family or not, distinct from Dravidian. So this is a fact. And there are similarities between the Indo-Aryan branch and the Dravidian and the European branches of Indo-European languages, and Dravidian is not related. So I will give some examples. See, languages, if you show these objectors, you know, people who refuse to accept this idea of Indo-European languages, if you show them similarities between Sanskrit and English or Latin or Greek, they say, oh, people always borrow words. So what happened was that India had a very high civilization in ancient times. Those people spread all over the world, and all the other people were influenced by them and they borrowed words from them. So it's not that their languages are related to us. It's just that they borrowed words from us. So we will show that it is not a question of borrowed words. It is a question of linguistic relationship between the languages. So next, I'll give some examples of words to show what is this. Now take these relation words. See, I have given in all these languages. Look at the screen. Sanskrit, English, Persian, Tocharian, B, Old Slavonic, that is Old Russian, Latin, Old Irish. See all the words for father, mother, brother, sister, son, and daughter. See the Persian word, pidar, mother, biradar, khasar, hunu, and in Avestan, hunu is in the Avestan, and dukhtar. They are used in Urdu. You'll realize there is one Kashmiri terrorist female organization called Duktare Millat or something. Duktarhane Millat or something like that, I think. So you see, these Persian words are used in India. We are familiar with them because they are used in Urdu and in Hindi films and all that. And English we all know. We are speaking in English now. So you just see the words and you see how they are all connected. And if you compare Tamil, you will see how different the words are. Tande, Tai, Annan, Tambi, Akkal, Tangi, Pen and Pen. These are relation words I'm giving. And these are the basic ones I'm giving. Even when you go ahead to son-in-law, uncle, aunt, you find all these connections. Or take the words for three. Now, I want everyone to just look at this screen. See the words for three in all the major Indo-Aryan languages of India. See them in the Iranian languages. See them in all the other Indo-European languages outside India. You see this thread. You can immediately, even a child will say that all these are related to each other. All these words, three, 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 two, three, like that. And you look at Dravidian words in our own country. Tamil is Moonru. Malayalam is Moonru. Telugu is Moodu. Kannada is Mooru. Tulu is Mooji. The Gond language is Moon. Toda is Mood. Kodagu is Moodu. Brahit is Moosi. You see that moo, 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 which gets repeating in all these. Then there is a third family of languages in India, that is the Austric. In the Santali, for example, the word for three is pa, paya or pa. And it is related, you see, it is not connected with the moo words or the three words. The Austric languages are related to Cambodian and Vietnamese languages. And in Vietnamese, the word for three is ba. So, pa, ba. You see the connection there. So, this is so clear. Now, what happens is that I have given examples of relation words and number words, which clearly show the relationship between all these different Indo-European languages and a complete difference from the Dravidian languages. But this is very strong evidence. If you see almost all the words, you can make out the connection. But it is not clinching evidence. Why? Because if you see now, these words can be borrowed. That is why I want to show this distinction between words which can be borrowed and which cannot be borrowed. Now, when we are speaking in our Indian languages today, we use words like mummy, daddy, uncle, auntie, brother, sister very freely. Then we also use numbers. If someone wants to say, he says, 4,526 rupees ho gaya uska kimmat, uska dam. Means they'll be using English numerals very, especially if they're studied in English, they'll be more used to using them and they'll use those numbers even when talking in Indian languages. So while this shows the relationship, it is not clinching evidence that they are related. These words could be borrowed by a stretch of imagination. But now we will see certain words which can never be borrowed. They are personal pronouns and the fundamental tense forms of the basic verb to be. So first, we'll see the personal pronouns. Now, as I showed the words for three, now look at the words for second person singular personal pronoun in all the Indo-European languages. Tu, 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 tu. It goes on through that full list if you go tu, du, si, tu, varieties of that. And look at Tamil, the Dravidian languages. Ni, 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 nu, ni, like that. So you see there are two different groups of words. One is the Indo-European word and second is the Dravidian word. Now we already saw that in the case of numbers and relations. But you know, numbers and relations can be borrowed. But I defy anyone in this who is listening to me right now. Each of them must be knowing at least two languages, right? English, Hindi, maybe their mother tongue. I defy them to speak a whole paragraph normally in their own language using English personal pronouns rather than their own language pronouns, or speak in English using the personal pronouns of their own language. You cannot transfer these words from one language to another very easily. Now see the words for am, art, and is. Means I am, thou art, he, she, it, is. Now in Sanskrit it is asmi, asi, asti. Look at Avestan, ahmi, ahi, asti. You know S in Sanskrit becomes H in Avestan. Look at Greek of Homer, of the Iliad and Odyssey. It is M-E-S-E-S-T. You see Hittite, which is the oldest language in West Asia. And it has become very different from other languages. But see, these words have not changed. It is Eshmi, Eshi, Eshi. See, Russian and Lithuanian. What is in Sanskrit? Asmi, Asi, Asti has become Eshmi, Eshi, Eshi. Only A has become A. So these are like dialects of one language. Whereas compared to Dravidian languages, Irukiren, Irukirai, Irukiran, Irukirai, Irukiridu. It's there, you can see it on the screen, all these words. They have no connection with these words at all. See what is in the modern languages of North India. See, in Marathi, it is mi ahe, tu ahes, to ahe. In Konkani, it is haam asta, tu asta, to asta. In Hindi, it is main hu, tu hai, wo hai. And so on. So you see, for example, in Marathi, the first and third person word is same, second person word is different. In Hindi, and in Gujarati, the second and third person words are same and first person is different. In Bengali, Sindhi and Punjabi, all three are different from each other. And in Konkani, all three are same. So you see, not only are the words different, but even the semantic meanings are different. So much changes have taken place. Does it mean these languages are not related to Sanskrit? They are, because you know, you can trace how these words got derived from Sanskrit words. But you can't trace the Tamil, Malayalam, Telugu words from Sanskrit words. So you can borrow relation words and number words, but you cannot borrow personal pronouns or the fundamental tense forms of the basic verb to be. These prove that there is such a thing as Indo-European languages. There is such a thing as Dravidian languages. They are two different. The only question before us is, where did the Indo-European languages originate? So we have to accept the following fact, that these 12 branches are indeed actually related branches of one language family, Indo-European. And their ancestors must have been ancestral forms of these languages. Like we have father, grandfather, grandmother, like these languages also keep changing and they split and this thing. So those ancestral forms must have been spoken in one area. They can't be that automatically Irish came into being in Ireland and Sanskrit came into being in India. They must have been in one place and then separated and spread out. So either the Indo-European languages of Europe went out from India, or the Indo-European languages of India came from Europe or somewhere outside. You cannot have a third option. You can't say, no, let's not. Maybe they were always there and we were always here. These languages, I mean, not the people. Maybe those languages were always there. Our languages were always in North India. There's no connection between them. You can't say that. There is no third option. So if you want to refute the Aryan invasion theory, you have to show that if the languages did not come from there to here, they definitely went from here to there. So if you say, I'm not bothered about OIT, I will just show how old our Sanskrit culture is, Vedic culture is, and that will automatically disprove the AIT. That is not going to happen. That is a myopic attitude. So there are basically, and why is our task very difficult? I'd like to explain. There are three claimants for this. The Pontic Caspian steppes, you know, they all talk about the steppes, Aryans coming from the steppes and all that. Then there's Anatolia or Turkey, and there is India. Three claimants. Now, the other two, those who support the other two theories, they have to argue for their homeland theory. If they support the Anatolian, they have to point out why they're supporting it and this. And so all they're only concentrating on that. None of them has to concentrate on refuting some invasion theory that someone says that Aryans came from outside and invaded Anatolia. So they don't have to sit down and disprove that, because that question is only not there. Only the homeland question is there in both those. But in the case of India, due to so many political factors, we have to, those who are arguing for against the AIT, they have to also, that is, they have two cases to fight. One is they have to disprove the invasion argument, and they have to present the out of India argument. So our task is much more difficult. And those who say OIT is not necessary, they're sabotaging their own case and converting it into a half case. They're only fighting half the battle and they're ignoring the other half. So that is the first thing that all people in this discussion should realize. Now, what are the basic issues? The basic question is, where is the homeland situated, right? But there are two parts to this. Firstly, what was the linguistic situation? Suppose you say this was the homeland, India, Anatolia, or the steppes. Then what happened inside that homeland? That is the first question, when all were together. And the second question is, the earliest we know of all these languages is when they were in their historical habitat. That is, the earliest we know of Sanskrit is in India. The earliest we know of Greek is in Greece. The earliest we know of Hittite is in West Asia, where it was first historically known. So, wherever that homeland was situated, how did they go from that homeland to that area? That is the second question. First is the homeland within the homeland, and second is the migrations from that homeland. So, the first thing about the homeland is based only on the about how they went out from those that homeland to other places. That can only be answered by analyzing the data from the relevant fields of scientific study, that is linguistics, textual inscriptional evidence, and archaeological evidence. This is the second question about how they went out from the homeland. But the first question about what happened inside that homeland, that also in the other respect of the other two homelands, you have to answer by speculation and theory and hypothesis. Only in the case of the Indian homeland theory, there is no need for speculation and hypothesis. We have actual recorded history of the Indo-European branches in the original homeland in India. So the Indian homeland theory is actually much stronger than the other two. Now, you must realize that as per all linguistic studies, these various branches started moving out of the homeland somewhere around 3000 BC. Now, 3000 BC is a time when we have records from China, we have records from Egypt, we have records from Mesopotamia. So it is not some prehistoric area, Paleolithic area, or some the area of dinosaurs. It is a recorded area in most of the civilizations of the world. So how is it that these Indo-Europeans, who became so important all over the world, how is it they don't have a record of 3000 BC? So you see, the other homeland theories choose to ignore that point, and they just go only in the field of speculation, hypothesis, and argument. However, in the case of India, we have the recorded history. There are two main fields from which we can discuss this. They are the two primary fields are linguistics, because the whole debate is about languages and their migration, right? Not about whether white-skinned people or blonde-haired people moved here or there, or certain genes or DNA went from one area to the other. It's not that. It is about these languages. And secondly, analysis of textual, inscriptional, and other recorded data. Only when records are there, you can talk. Otherwise, you are just talking in the air and speculating, right? If in some area, for example, in the Indus Valley now, Harappan site, if you actually find an inscription and it is read, like, you know, the Brahmi script was not read until some European scholars deciphered it. And once it was read, all this thing about Ashoka and his pillars and his inscriptions and all became a part of our history. So until that language is deciphered, but even then, we knew that the Ashokan in the Maurya kingdom was an Indo-European language speaking or Aryan kingdom. We didn't require decipherment for that. But in the case of the Harappan civilization, we do require, because there is no recorded, it is not known what language was spoken. It was just discovered in the last century. And that is the case with all other Indo-European areas. If you are trying to talk about it as being the original homeland, there is no record anywhere. And wherever record is there, it will either be in inscription or it will be in some textual traditional memories, which have to be not taken on faith, but have to be examined and proved or disproved. Now, archaeology is also a primary relevant field, but it is a secondary. It has, when is it relevant? Only when you find written inscriptions there. As I said, you don't find them in either the steppes or Anatolia or in the Harappan site. Texts which can be read are not found. So archaeology is can be primary only when you find written records. Otherwise, it is the most important secondary field, because you can take other aspects and argue. It's not proof. And all other fields of scientific study, all others, whether you say astronomy or even genetics, if people somehow try to show that it is also relevant, even then they become important only in the manner in which they fit in with the data of linguistics and textual proof, evidence. So these are the two primary ones, linguistic and textual. So next, out of India theory, I'll give the textual. Now the Rig Veda is the oldest recorded Indo-European language document. Now, I have shown in many books and articles, too long to show in this talk, that the Mitanni people had migrated from the Rigvedic area during the period of composition of the new Rig Veda. Now, to some listener who doesn't know all this, he'll have to go through my blog. But I have shown that the Rig Veda consists of two parts, and not shown only on my listing, shown on the linguistic evidence and the testimony of Indologists. And these two parts are the new Rig Veda and the old Rig Veda. And the Mitanni people were speaking a language which was related to the new Rig Veda, which contains a large number of words and forms which were not there in the old Rig Veda. And they are found in the Mitanni, and they are found in the Avestan Avesta also of Iranian. So now the Mitanni people were there in 1500 BC already as an established people. So backdating from that, I have shown that the oldest parts of the old Rig Veda go beyond 3000 BC. Now, what do the oldest parts of the old Rig Veda show? At this date, at 3000 BC, they show that the composers were initially inhabitants of an area in Haryana. In Haryana, not everywhere, but only in and around Haryana, in the oldest period of the old Rig Veda. They had no memories of any extra origin. They didn't even know areas outside India at that time. And certainly they had no idea that they or their ancestors had come from somewhere else. And they were attached to that area with ancestral ties. Anyone who analyzes the Hindus will see that. And they had no acquaintance with any local non-Indo-European people. That is, in 3000 BC, they were spread out in Haryana. Before 3000 BC, they were not aware of any non-Indo-European, Dravidian, Austric, Sumerian, Burushaski, Andamanese, Sino-Tibetan, Ural-Altaic, whatever, nothing. All the names in that are Indo-Aryan names. So, which means there were no non-Indo-European people in that full area in 3000 BC. And all the local rivers and animals in the oldest books have purely Indo-Aryan names. So this history of the oldest Rigvedic people goes back beyond 3000 BC. But linguists have analyzed on the basis of linguistic evidence, which shows that all the 12 branches were geographically located in nearby areas, so that they had contact with each other and influence each other till around 3500 to 3000 BC. So at the time of composition of the old Rig Veda, those other 11 branches also must have been somewhere around Haryana, where they were still in some way in contact, not completely broken away from the Vedic people. And the Iranian speakers were there for an even longer period of time because they share the new Rigvedic elements, etc. So they must have been somewhere close to the Rigvedic people who were in Haryana in 3000 BC. So therefore, there has to be some evidence of correlation between the 12 branches and the traditional historical paradigm of different peoples or tribes. You know, our Puranas don't tell us about Proto-Greeks and Proto-Slavonic and Proto-Germanic people and all. They talk in terms of tribes. So we have a traditional historical paradigm of different peoples or tribes living in North and Northwestern India. Now, when the Puranas start their traditional narrative, they give a mythological beginning that there was an ancient king called Manu Vaivaswat who had 10 sons, and from his 10 sons, all the people of India are descended. That is the main point of the Puranas. But although they talk about 10 sons and their descendants, actually all the history is concerned with only two main lunar tribes, Kurus and Yadus, and one solar tribe, Ikshvakus. You will see, like, the Ramayana is about the Ikshvakus, the Mahabharata is about the Purus, and then of course Yadus because Krishna is there and all. And all in traditional history, these are the three main groups. The Anus and Druhyus are located to the west and northwest of the Purus. And according to the traditional literature, the Druhyus migrated out of India in a very ancient period. And then the Anus occupied the areas. Therefore, it is clear that the Druhyus represent the first Indo-European migration of branches out of India, who went out from India into Afghanistan, then migrated northwards into Central Asia, and then migrated towards Europe and Anatolia, that is the Hittites. Now, the Rigveda records a major event, the Dasharadne battle, in the oldest books. The Druhyus went out in pre-Rigvedic times, remember. Now, in the Rigvedic, the oldest period, the Dasharadne battle took place in the Punjab between the Puru king Sudas and 10 Anu tribes, because the Anus were occupying that full area at that time, to the west of Haryana, to the west of the Rigvedic people. Now, the Rigveda contains 1,028 hymns and 10,552 verses, but just 4 verses from 2 hymns give us this solid evidence. It records the names of the Anu tribes who fought against Sudas. Look at the figures. 1,028 hymns. Just 2 of them give us this data. Out of 10,552 verses, only 4 give. So it's not, you know, like TNO and all that some people claim. He picks some word from some text, from any text from anywhere in the world, from any period, and he tries to connect them. This is solid historical data given in this Dasharadne hymns. Now, all the names can be identified with the earliest known, later to this, but earliest known historical names of people belonging to 4 of the Indo-European branches. There are 12 branches. So 4 of them, Iranian, Armenian, Albanian, and Greek. Their ancient names are recorded as the tribes who fought against Sudas. Now, linguists, you know, on the basis of linguistic analysis, they have also said, you know, this was the homeland, Tepis, of course. From there, the Hittites migrated first, then the Tokharian migrated, then the 5 European branches migrated, etc. And finally, there were 5 branches remaining in the homeland, according to the linguists. They were these same 4 branches and Indo-Aryan. And in this battle, you find Indo-Aryan kings fighting against the ancestors of the other 4 branches who are all located in this Punjab Haryana area in that time. So after that, you know, there are this migration of, in my books, I have given much more detail concerning the Avesta and other Iranian history, etc. I will not go into all that now. I have given it in my blog, the Aryan story versus true Aryan history. You can see it on my blog, or it must be there in academia also, since I put all my articles there. Then I have given all the evidence till then, means on 27, 2020, I wrote this, gave the final version of this article, the full out of India case in short, revised and enlarged. Then again, I only took up the linguistic case and gave a talk, of which that PowerPoint program of that talk, I have put up as an article, The Complete Linguistic Case for the Out of India Theory. Now, after that, objections raised by critics on specific points, even if those objections have been made on Twitter, if I thought them important enough, I have been completely answered them in numerous articles on my blog. And then whenever any new evidence came up after these above summaries, I have again given new articles about them. So now the case has been presented in full. I'm not saying more evidence will not come, but it will just be added to this existing mass of evidence. So the out of India theory is now complete. I have presented this out of India theory like this, but there are other many important scholars who have done studies. As I said, they have not presented this study about OIT, but they have presented other studies which buttress this theory by giving very strong positive evidence. And they have analyzed other, as I said, linguistics and textual, mainly linguistic and archaeological data, like D.B. Lal, archaeology, Nicholas Kazanas, linguistics, and A.A. Semenenko and Koenraad Elst. Both have written on a wide number of fronts and on summarizing this OIT case. Now, the entire case is now unanswerable. And the only major thing preventing it from being accepted is politics and coordinated stonewalling from the deeply entrenched vested interests on the AIT side. Now, we can, we do, blame the AIT side and the huge number of allies that they have everywhere, who are anti-Hindu or anti-Indian or various other reasons are there. They may not have been anti to begin with, but as the dialogue debate progressed, they became more and more anti-Hindu and anti-Indian. I won't say they were like that to begin with, all of them. Now, while blaming them, we cannot remain silent on the fact that there are many internal stumbling blocks from within the anti-AIT and the general Hindu side. You know, we represent Hindu culture and Hindu point of view, but all Hindus don't necessarily see it like that, unfortunately. Firstly, the Aryan invasion theory is backed by a wide spectrum of official, national and international, academic, media and political forces. While the out of India theory is officially a neglected orphan, no one is backing it officially anywhere. Secondly, I have already described in the beginning, most anti-AIT writers, they are only concerned with showing that the Vedas go back or that they are connected with the Harappan civilization. But either they fail or they refuse to accept the importance of the OIT on linguistic and textual ground. That is a big stumbling block. So that has to be that they have to accept it and move together, everyone. But there are other vested interests. Even from among those who may not be anti-OIT, they are not inimical to the idea of OIT, but they have their own, you know, prejudices and biases and obsessions, because of which they have contributed to fudging the issues and preventing the united presentation of a full OIT version. So I will just go through them. Which are these other vested interests, the internal stumbling blocks? First of all, are the fundamentalist religious elements who insist that the Vedas are divine, timeless, revealed texts which cannot give us any history. And they reject any analysis which uses Western tools. They make it an Indian versus Western rather than AIT versus OIT issue. And they say linguistics was invented by in the last 200, 300 years. They can't tell us our ancient history. They reject ideas of language family and Proto-Indo-European. And they reject any analysis which goes beyond the traditional Indian methods and parameters of textual analysis. You know, we have a huge and massive history of 2000 years of analyzing text. People wrote commentaries on books, they wrote commentaries on those commentaries, and then they discussed them and had debates. So they say we should use their methods. But you know, those people did not know that there was such a thing as Indo-European language family. So they could not have discussed this issue. This is a new issue which has come to our knowledge now after contact with Europeans, etc. So we have to use methods and sciences which are applicable now. That is the first group, the more fundamentalist ones who want just traditional and religious. Then there are those who have no objection, but the only objection is, why do you think that there was Proto-Indo-European and then other groups went out? No, Vedic Sanskrit was the original language. And all those who went out, they took Vedic culture. Otherwise, they agree with your OIT, but don't bring in all this PI and all. It is the Vedic people who went out and took our culture all over the world. That is the second group. Now, thirdly, there is a large body of Hindus addicted to the idea that Vedic culture was the source and fountainhead of at least the whole of Indian culture and civilization, if not world culture and civilization. So they want to trace everything from India, you know, whether it is the Auric people or even the Andamanese or something. Somehow they'll try to show there's some connection with the Puranas and Vedic this thing, and try to say they all came from this culture. So what I have shown is that Vedic culture was the culture of just one tribe, the Purus, who lived in and around Haryana. And there were many other cultures of many other ancient Indian tribes all over India, which later, when all Hinduism united all this, now they are all parts of Hinduism, but they were not part of Vedic culture. And I have written many detailed articles on this. So they find it absolutely unacceptable. They feel that I am reducing the status of the Rig Veda and the Vedic text from the ancestral to just one group. But that is the fact, and nothing to be ashamed of. Everything starts in one place. Now, there, on the other hand, more modern people like archaeologists, geneticists, and others, they want to derive all Indian cultures and all Indian people also from the culture of the Harappan. So, you know, they say all of Indians are descended from the Harappan. How can they be? The Harappan culture was restricted geographically to one area in the northwest and north. Do you mean to say all the rest of India was absolutely a desert with no people staying there? Obviously, there were cultures and civilizations all over, the different degrees of civilized people all over India. So this is one stumbling block. They all want one fountainhead of Indian. Now, there is, among them, there are many people who do study. I will not name names, but I think people will be aware of what I am talking about, who feel that Indian history should be written according to the Puranas and epics. And they want Vedic history to include an account for every major king, dynasty, kingdom and sage recorded in these texts. You know, they don't want it restricted to the Purus of Haryana and all. So they go to the Puranic list. They even count number of generations between different kings. They say that between this king, there were four generations or six generations. How do you know? Because the lists are not complete lists. And even they have been drawn up, you know, by collating the Puranic material by scholars. For example, if you see those who have written on the Puranic list, Pargitar, Smith, Pusalkar, etc., you look at the list and you see they're all different from each other. They're not exactly similar. In fact, there are very glaring differences among the three lists. So, yes, the study of the Puranas and epics is very important because that is our history and tradition, our traditional history. So, it has to be done. You must write books on Puranic history and the epic history. But when you obsess with combining it with the Rig Vedic history, and then you want to find persons from one and the other and somehow combine the two, and when it intrudes into the Rig Vedic analysis with reference to the Aryan debate, then it becomes a big problem. In this context, and this is what I meant, there are scholars who want at least to identify the major Puranic epic persons, dynasties and tribes in the region of the Rig Vedic people on the banks of the Saraswati or in the cities of the Harappan civilization. Means they want that these, at least, if not everyone, at least these main tribes must have originated there. And they are the Ikshvakus, Yadus and Purus. As I said, all our traditional history is concentrated on these three groups. So when I say Purus alone were in that, they represented the Saraswati civilization and culture, they don't like it. Now, I have pointed out actually that the Harappan culture was not just Puru culture. Purus were in the northeastern part of it. Below them were, to the west and south of them, were the Anus, and originally even the Druyus who migrated out, and the Yadus to the south. But these people want the Saraswati to be the center where the Rig Veda was composed, to be the central original point of all these, at least these three tribes, and if possible, all the other tribes. Now, there is no such data in either the Rig Veda or in the Puranas and epics which can be interpreted like this. So then there is a full-fledged agenda of misinterpretation and distortion of the Rig Vedic and Puranic epic data. So this is a big stumbling block, especially, I mean, I know I'm being selfish here, but I feel that my, what I have presented to OIT, it can be hijacked into a different plane and be taken off at a tangent. So I feel it's necessary to say this. Next, then there is of course a large group of writers who want to take traditional Indian historical events back by thousands, 10,000s or even lakhs of years. And they find a wide range of sciences to support their this thing. Now, I will say, admit that these people don't really interfere with our OIT paradigm. Because they are only obsessed with chronology. They're not obsessed with tampering with any of the OIT. They will agree with the OIT, but they say, no, your dates are wrong. The dates must go long behind. That is the sixth group. Now, every single one of these groups has large fan followings, which are always militantly up in arms. You know, I am abused, the Koenraad Elst is abused many times on social media, apparently, by people belonging to all these six groups because we are not pandering to their, you know, obsessions or whatever. So, because of that, there cannot be general acceptance of any rational out-of-India theory or any rational interpretation of historical data. And they are as much a problem as any AIT fan. So naturally it makes job very easy for AIT protagonists, because when one side is divided, they can just sweep through. So basically, we must remember the OIT is basically irrefutable. And we can only keep strengthening its nature by presenting new evidence whenever it comes up and answering all arguments. But unless there is a rational consensus among Hindus of all brands, the stalemate will only continue. And the victory of the OIT will only remain confined to what you very correctly described as a few echo chambers. So, that is the problem. We have to all present a united front. That is what I am meant to say in all that I have been talking about till now. Now I will present the archaeological case and the linguistic case in short for the out of India theory. Now the textual, I have written in detail, and I already told you what the OIT was, which is all about the textual. So now let us see the archaeological evidence. Now, firstly, archaeology has not been able to provide any evidence for the movement of Indo-European groups from the steppes to Central Asia, or from Central Asia to the Vedic Harappan area, or even from the Vedic Harappan area to the rest of North India, which is what the theory is all about. There is no archaeological support for any of these stages. In fact, archaeologically, they have not even been able to identify any particular archaeological culture as Proto-Indo-European, Proto-Indo-Iranian, or even Vedic. Because actually, as we saw, the Harappan sites of the Northeast are Vedic, but they reject that. So apart from that, they have not been able to identify anything anywhere as Vedic PIE or PIIR, that is Proto-Indo-Iranian. And when they do make attempts, you know, some archaeologists find something in somewhere on the way from the steppes to India, some archaeological material is uncovered. And immediately they say, these were the Aryans on the way to India and Iran. But more serious and honest archaeologists completely reject these. For example, I have given quotations in my book from archaeologists like Frankfurt and Lambert Karlovsky. They completely reject all these attempts to identify some archaeological site as Indo-European in any way. And they point out that the kind of logic that these archaeologists use when they try to, you know, identify these sites, the logic they, if you use that same logic, you can even identify Chinese, Arab, Turk, or even Red Indian sites of America as Indo-Iranian. If you use that kind of vague logic, you know, they use boats. The Indo-Europeans use boats, so they must be Indo-Europeans. That kind of nonsense. Now, for all the other Indo-European branches, there is at least archaeological evidence which shows the entry of outsiders into those areas. In all these cases, for example, in the case of Armenia, there is no archaeological evidence, but the names of all the local places and are non-Armenian and non-Indo-European. So there you have that evidence that they came from out, which is not there for the Rig Veda, because all the local place names and river names are Indo-Aryan. Now, but for all the other branches, there is archaeological material showing the entry of Indo-European speakers into those areas. Always, of course, with the caution that when we say Indo-European speakers, we don't have written material, but they fit in into every other criterion. But in the case of India alone, archaeologists have not been able to find any people coming into India in the dates, in the period, which the linguists say they must have come in. So, for example, and this is not only our Indian archaeologists or Hindu archaeologists saying it. There was a conference in Toronto in 1991, which was attended by a large number of Western linguists and Western archaeologists. They were the two types of scholars who attended a conference and presented papers. And one of them was Vidjel. And Vidjel and Erdosi have compiled the volume containing all those papers. Now, all those, I have given the details from that in my book, but all the archaeologists there completely reject the Aryan invasion theory. They say there is no archaeological proof for it at all. They say that between the 5th century and the 5th millennium and the 1st millennium, that is around 4000 BC to 1000 BC, there is no archaeological record of people coming in from outside. So after 1000 BC, of course, we have the Aryans all over India. And before 4000 BC, the linguistic evidence does not allow Aryans to be coming into India. They have to be coming after 3000 BC. But that is not supported by the archaeologists. So all these people, these archaeologists have pointed out that this is too early and too late to have any connection with Aryans. Whatever archaeological evidence is there of people entering into India, they have nothing to do with Aryans. In matters of migration, we must remember that archaeological evidence can only be found at the end point of the migration, not at the starting point. Like if, for example, your relatives go and stay in America, afterwards they will be recorded there as citizens, they will be paying taxes there. So we have records of them there. But in modern times, of course, we will have records of them migrating there also. But in ancient times, when people migrated from one area to another, they did not leave some signs here, you know. Suppose they migrated from India, they did not leave pillars saying that we are migrating to Anatolia, we are migrating to. They just went. So whatever evidence you find, that archaeological evidence will be found at the end point, not at the starting point. For example, Europeans went to the American continent 3 centuries ago, 4 centuries ago, and they completely, they have taken over the North and South America. But archaeological material for this migration can be found in America, because then you see all European artifacts appearing in America. But it will not be found in Europe. But later, you know, Native American artifacts would start appearing in Europe, but only because the Europe-America context remained extremely strong and there was interaction. People came from Europe to America, England, America had this thing, the English were ruling them until they broke free from them, etc. But in ancient times, when the Indo-Europeans migrated to another place, they completely lost contact with the home area. So you will find evidence only of the home area culture in the migrated areas. You won't find in the home area, you won't find archaeological proof that someone migrated from here. Only where they land up, you will find proof that someone came from out and landed here. Now, as I said, in the case of India, there is proof that no one landed here in those areas. But then some people say, but what is the proof that they went out from India? What is the proof? As I said, there is no proof. You cannot find proof of emigration from some area. You can only find proof of immigration. Unless, you know, there is a recorded area and all. There is no record anywhere. So we cannot give proof. Now, the evidence for immigration in all the other Indo-European areas is so strong, archaeological evidence, except in India. And that itself is strong archaeological evidence for the OIT and against the AIT. Now, at the same time, although, as I said, you won't really find evidence at the starting point and on the way, not necessarily. But archaeologists like D.B. Lal and numerous other scholars have actually provided detailed data showing identity between Harappan archaeology and Vedic texts. The presence of, for example, Vedic fire altars have been found in Harappan sites. Now, those who say these are not Vedic fire altars, where else have you found them? They have not been found anywhere except in these Vedic sites. And later they are found all over North India, of course. Now, A.A. Semenenko, in his brilliant Sangam Talks presentation on 29th January, he has provided details of very, I saw the PowerPoint presentation which he had put up on Academia, and it is brilliant. He has shown so many, seals and photographs of Harappan artifacts, which I had never seen. For example, there's a dancing girl, we all know, but he shown another dancing girl figurine, which I had never seen. So his article is, his that talk and the presentation is presented is really brilliant. It shows the connection between Harappan archaeology and Vedic text. Now, those who object, who say that, but there are no special Harappan features in the Rig Veda, there are no cities, there are no drainage systems described, there are no street lights, all these things that you find in Harappan. So, but then can you show some place where special Vedic features are found and which can be fitted into the AIT paradigm? Because the AIT has a time frame that the Aryan entered at this time, then they went here, then they went here. But none of these are supported by archaeological data. So their objections need not be taken seriously. When they are not given proof, they have no right to demand proof from us. Basically, there is no archaeological evidence showing that the Harappan civilization was non-Vedic or non-Indo-European. That is the fact that emerges from all this. One archaeological factor showing the identity of Vedic and Harappan culture is the pastoral nature of the proto-Indo-European and Vedic cultures. You know, even these people talk about pastoral steppe people who came to India. So they accept that that was the most characteristic feature of the Aryans, who they say came from the steppes, that they were pastoral. Pastoral means who had cattle, bred cattle, and had dairying industry, etc. Now, the reconstructed Proto-Indo-European pastoral vocabulary, which has been reconstructed by the linguist, is most fully represented in the Vedic vocabulary. That is, they have 8 words for cow in Proto-Indo-European. And Vedic Sanskrit is the only language which has all those 8 words. Others have 2 or 3 or 4. So, which means that Vedic pastoral culture is very close to Proto-Indo-European pastoral culture. But the only cattle found archaeologically in the whole of India from ancient times to recent times is the Indian species Bos indicus, which was domesticated by the Harappans. So this was obviously the only species of cattle known to the Vedic people. So by implication, this was also the only species of cattle known to the Proto-Indo-Europeans, whose pastoral vocabulary is fully represented in the Rig Veda. Also, while there is evidence that there was no immigration of Western cattle into India, because none have been found, except in recently, Jersey cows were brought here and crossbred, etc. That is a modern colonial phenomenon. Before that, there were no Western cattle in India. But there is plenty of archaeological evidence for the emigration of Indian cattle and also Indian elephants and Indian peacocks to West Asia and Central Asia in periods represented historically by the first appearance of the Mitanni in West Asia. So you see, this is a very strong factor. And as a corollary to the above, there is the distribution of high lactase persistence is a very important factor, which I presented recently in the IIT seminar. Although I was not present there, I sent a paper to that effect. Now, what is lactase persistence? You know, all mammals, when they are born, they have only milk for a certain period. After that, they are weaned away from milk. Then they start taking other food. Then what happens is that the ability to digest milk decreases and sometimes even goes completely after that weaning period. So, but in certain parts of the world where cattle were domesticated and there was a flourishing pastoral culture, there you find high lactase persistence. That is, even after the weaning period, the people can still digest milk. Otherwise, that ability to digest milk goes. So, now, in Romero, this paper by Romero, he has shown exactly where in India there is high lactase persistence today, in today's date. And if you look at that map, all the areas with high lactase persistence are the areas of the erstwhile Harappan civilization. In the south, there is much less. In the east of India also, there is much less lactase persistence. But it is very high in the Harappan areas. Now, we know that the Harappans were one of the two domesticators of cattle species in the whole world. You can check encyclopedias and Wikipedia and all that for that. Two species of cattle were domesticated in the world, of cows. One was Bos indicus in India and Bos taurus in Turkey, not even in Europe, not even in the steppes. And so these Harappan people were the people who domesticated Indian cattle. So they are one of the most, they are, should be having the highest lactose persistence, because they are the ones who have been, since 7,000 or 8,000 years, they have been using these Indian cattle. Now, what does this show? That even today, this lactase persistence is there in that very area. So what does this mean? That means that all these theories that the Harappans went were driven to the south and east and all is not true, because if that was so, that lactase persistence would have been in the south or the east. Whereas it is still there in the same Harappan areas. So this shows that there was no major exchange of population, no major Aryans coming and taking over the north, no Harappan being driven to the south, etc. Even in Harappan and pre-Harappan times, the same, so more or less, you know, all the, of course, barring, you know, internal migration, which are always taking place everywhere, but by and large, the people of all the different parts of India are descendants of people who lived in those very areas 5,000, 6,000 years ago, by and large. So this is a completely disproves the Aryan invasion theory, because not only do they not bring Western cattle, but the only lactase persistence found is in the Harappan areas and not anywhere else. So that Harappan areas are the areas described in the Rig Veda. They are the areas found by archaeologists for the Harappan civilization. And those are the areas where there is lactase persistence. So what you see archaeologically, that the Harappans domesticated cattle is represented textually in the Rig Veda. And back, going back also in the Proto-Indo-European reconstructed culture. So this is the very strong evidence for the out-of-India theory and the Indian homeland theory. Now, there have been many scholars in recent times who have presented very significant archaeological data showing movements of people from India to the West. Means apart from this cattle moving west and Indian elephants moving west and all that. A recent presentation by A.A. Semenenko called Step Route of Indo-European Dispersals, which also was presented by in Sangam Talk on 12th February, is a prime example of this. So there are scholars now who are, although it is not easy to get evidence of emigration from the starting point, yet this paper by A. Semenenko is a prime example of a really magnificent achievement in this regard. And hopefully there are many more scholars who will be also doing this and whose research may come to light very soon. Now he locates the Proto-Indo-European homeland in the border region between India and Iran. Now, this is the very area where interaction continued between the Puru Anu Druhu Proto-Indo-European groups after the Anus and Druhus had spread out from the east, as detailed in my books and papers on the basis of the textual evidence. So here we have archaeology completely backing the OIT and completely failing to support the Aryan invasion theory. Now, equally based on textual and archaeological evidence, you know, I always present it as textual evidence, but it is basically archaeological evidence. Because, see, we have the Harappan seals, but they have not really been satisfactorily deciphered to the acceptance of everyone. In fact, I don't think they have been deciphered satisfactorily. So, the earliest written data that we have about India is in the Ashoka pillar. So, whether you like Ashoka or not, you have to give him credit for one very great thing, that Indian history at least has a point of reference because of his pillars. Otherwise, you know, they would have brought Aryans into India even 100 years, 1000 years ago. But they can't go after Ashoka's pillars, because we know, and of course the Buddhist texts also confirm, that the whole of North India was Indo-European in the first millennium BC. Now, this is significant because before the Ashoka pillars, the only attested Indo-Aryan words are in 1500 BC and earlier in Syria and Iraq in West Asia. The Mitanni kingdom covered a huge area there for around 150 to 200 years. Now, as I have shown, see, this is the archaeological proof of what I have given from the textual evidence. The Mitanni took with them the vocabulary of the new Rigveda. So, since they are already there in West Asia in 1500 BC and even earlier, because see, I have quoted in my books scholars like Witzel saying that they were not Mitanni. Their ancestors brought the Mitanni language there. So, which means that the ancestors who went from India were there at least 200, 300 years earlier. Now, they could have migrated from India only before 2000 BC to account for the chronology of their attested presence there. So the old Rigveda must naturally come before the new Rigveda. So it's just, as I have already said all this, the only point I'm making here is that this is not just textual evidence, it is archaeological evidence because of the Mitanni inscription. So now the AIT, that was for archaeological. You see, we have evidence, archaeological evidence, for against the AIT, for the OIT, but there is no archaeological evidence for the AIT. So now we come to the linguistic evidence, because this whole debate is about languages. So it is basically a purely linguistic problem. Now the only three basic facts, as I already said, is that 12 branches are there related to each other. All of them must be going back to an ancestral language, and all of them must have been in one homeland. So that is what this whole linguistic debate is about. But there is no linguistic evidence for a non-Indian homeland or against the OIT. In fact, as shown repeatedly in my articles and books and by many other scholars, all the evidence supports the out-of-India theory. And all the arguments which are claimed to support the AIT actually turn out to support the OIT. I've given many examples, like the Uralic languages are full of Indo-Iranian word, and that is always given as proof of the AIT. But I have shown how it is in fact proof of the out of India theory. So you see, many which they claim are AIT arguments are actually OIT arguments. So I will give some of the main arguments in this case. See, Johanna Nicol, anyone who has read my books will be familiar with this. She has pointed out there are several kinds of evidence for the, and she's a official Western academic, and a group of scholars from that university in America did research, and they combined these two volumes, and their conclusion was that there are several kinds of evidence for the Proto-Indo-European locus. What is locus? It's the area from where people spread out. And the evidence she gives is for the European languages. She can't give for the Indian and Iranian languages. And that locus, she gives a whole, if you go through this paragraph, she says the structure of the family tree, genetic diversity, location of Tokharian, early attestation of Anatolian, the east-westward trajectories of languages, etc., etc., which is all too technical for us. But the conclusion from it is that the locus was to the east of the Caspian Sea. And after analyzing more linguistic factors, she finds that this was in ancient Bactria Sogdiana. What is Bactria Sogdiana? It is the part of Central Asia which covers northern Afghanistan and areas to its north. It is the very area which I have shown the textual proof of the Anus and Druids migrating out is from this area. So this is the locus of the Indo-European spread after a very detailed linguistic analysis of the evidence. Now, H.H. Hawk, he's a strong AIT supporter. I have even written a blog article criticizing him. Now, he had pointed out that the early Indo-European languages contain certain linguistic features which cannot be captured by a tree diagram. Means you can't show this one, it divided into two, it divided into four, etc. You can show that some of them have some similarities with other branches and with some similarities with yet other branches. So this is called, he said, this can be shown on a map showing intersecting isoglosses. Now, what is isogloss? I have already spoken of it in previous talks, but I think I'll again clarify what it is. Now, you know, now languages of South India and the Dravidian languages, as well as Konkani, Marathi, Gujarati, and Oriya, they all have a sound L, you know, L, a cerebral L. So what Hindi would say kala, color. Maharashtrian would say kala. So that ala is the cerebral sound found in all these languages. Now this is not found in Hindi. So or other languages of the north. So you can draw a map showing this area where all these languages develop this sound in common. So what Hawk wanted to say was that if you see all the isoglosses which unite certain branches of Indo-European languages, you can draw a dialect, follow a dialectological approach and show how they migrated out of the homeland. Now, I have written in detail on this sheet down below the last line, 200 pages, 205 to 307, 102 pages of my book in 2008, I have shown how Hawk's claim is completely faulty. He tries to show that the isoglosses prove the out of India, the Indian Aryan invasion theory. Now, I have shown how they all fit in perfectly with the textual evidence for the OIT. And now we come to something which I just came across 2-3 years ago, evidence. You know, when I was in school and college, I had a passion for learning different alphabet languages, etc. And I can't learn too many languages, but I used to learn numbers 1 to 100 in various languages. And I had written them all in a notebook, which had become yellowed and was tearing. So I thought, what to do? I can't keep this book. I'll make an article and put all of them on the internet. And I intended that article to be that if you are studying a particular language and you want to know how that language forms the numbers from 1 to 100, you can find it in my article. So that was the purpose of the article, in which I gave a large number of languages, Indian, African, American Indian, Australian, etc., etc. Now, while I was preparing this article, I got this unbelievable evidence for the out of India theory. You know, decimal numbers in any language, they have followed a certain system. And when you analyze it, you see there are four stages in the development of decimals 1 to 100. Four stages. The first, for example, a classic example is Chinese. In the Chinese language, you have only 11 words. Words for 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and a word for 100. And out of these 11 words, you make all the words from 1 to 100. Then the second stage is, classic example is Turkish. If you take international example. In Turkish, you have words from 1 to 10. And then you have words for 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, 100. And all the other words are formed out of these 19 words. This is the second stage of development. The third stage is found in, it will be found in the language that my listeners know. For example, English, Hindi, English, Tamil, Malayalam, French, whatever. This system, you have to learn the numbers from 1 to 20 by heart. And after that, you have to learn the numbers for 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, 100. And then the other numbers are formed by a system from based on these 28 words. Now, finally, you come to the fourth stage, which is found in the whole world, only in North India. The North Indian Indo-Aryan languages are in this fourth stage, where if you are learning a North Indian language, you have to learn all the 100 words by heart. You cannot learn a few words and automatically get, for example, bees, 21. Now, ek and bees combined to 21. How do you have to learn that word by heart? You can't automatically get it. Or take in Marathi. Take the words 15, 25, 35, 45, 55, 65. In English, it's very easy. You know the words for 20, 30, 40, 50, 60. You just add 5 to them and you get 25, 35, 45, 55, 65, etc. Whereas in Marathi, how do you get 15? It is Pandra. How do you get 25? It is Panch Vis. How do you get 35? It is Pastis. How do you get 45? It is Panche Chalis. How do you get 55? It is Pansa One. How do you get 65? It is Pa Tash. So you see that 5 only changes from Panch, Panche, Pansa, Pa, Pas, etc. So you have to learn that particular word in full. It's not like English that you automatically just put 5 behind it. It's not like that. So there are these four stages. Now, according to the theory, there was a Proto-Indo-European language, and then all these branches came into being. And the Hittite branch was the first to leave the homeland. Now, it so happened that we don't have the full number system of Proto-Indo-European or Hittite. So we don't know which stage it was, or these languages were in, the decimal system. So it may have been in stage 1 or stage 2, we can speculate. But Sanskrit in India, Tokharian to the north of India, and spoken Sinhalese to the south of India are all three in stage 2. Then all the other Indo-European languages, you know, Italic, Celtic, Germanic, Baltic, Slavic, Albanian, Greek, Armenian, Iranian, as well as literary Sinhalese. See, spoken Sinhalese is in stage 2. But literary Sinhalese, which was because after becoming Buddhist, they were influenced by the Prakrits of that period. So, it is based on a stage 3 Prakrit, which is not recorded anywhere. But this literary Sinhalese represents that stage 3 Prakrit. So, all are in stage 3. And the Dravidian language is also in stage 3. And only the modern Indo-Aryan languages are in stage 4. So here you see, where did these four stages develop? In North India, in India. See, the second stage is found in India, to the north of India and to the south of India. And all the other Indo-European branches, as well as the Dravidian languages, are in stage 3. Which means that the Dravidian languages were frozen at stage 3. While the North Indian languages moved on to stage 4. And the branches which went out of India also went out of India when India was in stage 3 of decimal numbers. So in India you find stages 2, 3, 4. Outside India you find only stage 3. So this shows that this full development took place in India. And this is the most strongest and very systematic proof for the out of India theory, because this has no explanation in any other homeland theory. Now, linguistic paleontology, you know, right from the first day of Indo-European studies, they have tried to reconstruct the culture of the Proto-Indo-Europeans. Now, how do they do that? They see there is an animal or a plant which has a similar name in English and in, say, Sanskrit. So that means that animal or plant was known to the ancestors. But if it is found only in one area, it may or may not have been known. There is no proof. So they took out all these common words and they claimed that these words prove the steppe homeland, because they show a temperate environment of animal and plant names. For example, bears, wolves, they are found in Europe, they are found in India. So they are common names. But they represent a colder area. They said there are no Indian animals, but this is wrong because they have suppressed the fact. They mention it and then they dismiss it, that there are common Indian names for elephant or ivory. This is Sanskrit Ibha, Rigvedic, it's the Rigvedic word, Greek Erpa Elephas, Latin Ebur, and Hittite Lapa. All of these can be derived from the root Rab or Lab, which became Rbha or Lbha. And what does this root mean? It means to grasp, to hold something. So the elephant holds things with its trunk. That's why the name for the elephant was derived from this verb, this root, Rbha, Lbha. Now, it is the same meaning as Hastin. The elephant does not have a hand. What do they mean? They mean its trunk, which is used like a hand to grasp things. So you see, it has that same etymology. And in the Rig Veda, there is a certain class of divine beings called Ribhu. What do? They work with the hand. They grasp things. They are artisans. They do work with the hand. So again, Hastin, Ribhu, and this word Ribalba, they all show that common origin. And these words are found in four different ancient languages. Iba in Sanskrit, Greek, Latin, and Hittite. So, and this, India is the only Indo-European language speaking area which has elephants. Outside that, they are found in Southeast Asia and they are found in the interior of Africa. This evidence conclusively proves the Indian homeland from linguistic paleontological ground and the OIT case. So it has been consistently stonewalled. They have no arguments against it, so they just keep it silent. And if they are forced to mention it somewhere in a line, they mention it and dismiss it. But it cannot be dismissed. It is the most solid evidence. Now, the Western and particularly the five European branches, Germanic, Celtic, Baltic, Slavic, and Italic, they have borrowed from a number of other language families as they moved west from India to Europe. And this gives proof of their movement from India to Europe. Now, three scholars, Chang, has proved that Chinese words are found in German, which shows that they went from this area. Gankrelidze and Ivanov, in their magnum opus on the Indo-European homeland, they have shown a large number of words from Yenisayan and Altaic branches, which are found in the European languages. And Nikos, in that, which I've already referred to her grand study, she has shown many Semitic words which went through Caucasian, that is the Georgian and other languages of the Caucasian mountains, into the language of the Europeans as they migrated west. So you see, so many different language families they have borrowed from as they went from India to the west, which have India, it are not found in Indo-Iranian. Now, two words much discussed as borrowings from Proto-Semitic are the words for wine and taurus. Taurus is the western wild cattle. These words were originally Semitic, you find that, and they were borrowed by Proto-Indo-Europeans. So these people say that, you know, Semitic areas are to the south of the steppes. So it proves that the Proto-Indo-Europeans were in the steppes. But actually it proves the opposite, because there are three branches to the east of the Semitic areas. They are Indo-Aryan, Iranian, and Tokharian. And these words are not found in these three branches, whereas they are found in all the other eight branches which are to the west of the Semitic. It shows that these words were borrowed when those eight branches were moving from east to west across the Semitic influenced areas. Whereas the three branches which remained in the east from before, from the beginning, they did not borrow these words. Now, this is what people would say is controversial. This scholar, Isidore Dien, presented a paper in a conference in 1970. It was published and presented in some conference, where he showed that Proto-Indo-European and Proto-Austronesian, that is the Malaysian and languages to the east in Southeast Asia, they have very similar words, such basic words as the first four numbers. Like in Malaysian language, do you know what are the numbers for 2, 3 and 4? Dua, Tiga and Patru, which are obviously like the Sanskrit Dua, Tri and Chatur. Then you say Chatur and Patru are different, but even in Romanian language, the word Cha has become P. So it is a regular Indo-European change. Now, Dayan points out, and also for some of the personal pronouns, and also for the words for water and land. Now, people will say, how can Indo-European have had connections in the ancient primitive past with the Austronesian languages? Even I cannot explain it, except that India is the closest to the Austronesian area. And certain scholars like Chatterjee had said that the Austronesian languages migrated east from India. Now, he also had no proof for it. So, we have no proof. But we have this fact that these all these words are very close to each other and must be showing some kind of context. Now, the Uralic languages, as I mentioned, contain a large number of words. Kuzmina in 2001 has given a big list of these words, which are borrowed from Indo-Aryan and Iranian. And this, again, ultra logic. They say that this proves that the Indo-Iranians came from the steppes close to the Finno-Ugrin areas. Finno-Ugrin means Finnish and Hungarian, the Uralic areas. But actually, the movement is in the opposite direction. Why? Because all these borrowings are in only one direction. That is, all have been borrowed from Indo-Iranian to Uralic. There is not a single accepted example of a borrowing in the opposite direction, although people have struggled to search for such words since many decades. Now, when does this happen? This situation takes place that one family borrows from the other, but the other does not borrow from the first family. This happens when migrants from one area go and settle in another area, and the local people borrow words from them. They also borrow words from the local people. But after some time, they merge among the local people. So what happens? The local languages contain words from their language, but where did those people go from? That area does not have those words. I give a practical example if you didn't understand what I'm saying. The Arabs, you know, after Muslims invaded India, many Arabs came, all including scholars and all, they came into India and then they have given birth to Urdu as a mixture of Hindi and Arabic words. You know, Hindi and Urdu are the same, except that it contains Arabic words and some Turkish and Persian words. Otherwise, grammatically, you'll say, main aaya tha, whether it is Hindi or Urdu, there's no difference. So many Arabic words are borrowed by them. Now, our mutt of my community is in Karnataka, and it's a Hindu religious mutt. But there is one ceremony which, in the evening, the lamp is lighted. We call it, it is called duty gay salam. Now, salam, duty gay is a Kannad word for lamp, that torch. And salam is obviously an Arabic word. So, you see, all over India, you will find Arabic words have been borrowed by the local languages. Why? Because the Arabs came to India. But in Arabia, those Arabs did not take back Indian words. So, Arabian language has not got Indian words. Similarly, you know, 1000 years ago, you have the Cambodian temples of Angkor Wat, etc. There were Hindu kingdoms there. Today, all the languages of Southeast Asia have so many Sanskrit words. But not one single Cambodian, Thai, Burmese, Vietnamese or Malaysian word has entered Sanskrit. Why? Because Sanskrit people went there, they didn't come here. And once they went there, after some time, they merged into the local people. Like Arabs who must have come here, whoever remained here, they merged into these people, Indians. And they did not take the words back to their homeland. Whereas English people came and stayed here, we borrowed from them, they borrowed from us. And then they went back to England and wrote books. And there was continuous contact. So the Indian words also went to England. But in ancient times, this two-way traffic was not there. There was only one-way traffic. So what this shows is that some people went from India and Iran, this area, to Eastern Europe, where the Uralic people were there. And this same situation took place there. Then the Indo-Iranians who went there merged with the local people. And they did not come back to India to give us some Uralic words. So we don't have any Uralic words. But the Uralic languages have Indo-Iranian words. So this is a strong proof. And second, even stronger proof is that one of the words borrowed by the Uralic languages is the Bactrian word for camel. You know the Bactria Margiana, which I already referred to from where the Indo-Europeans went. So some Indo-Iranians must also have gone with them or whatever. Anyway, their word has been taken from Bactria Organa. So how can you say these people came from there. Obviously, they whatever word they got was from migrants from this area to that area. Now, they have classified certain elements as pre-Indo-Aryan or even pre-Indo-Iranian. Many elements are there. Now, the surprising thing is, according to them, Indo-Iranians came from the steppes to Central Asia. Then they moved south and occupied the Harappan areas and the Vedic areas. And then they moved east. So, before that, they were together there. And whatever languages they brought with them were what these people call Indo-Iranian. And there are many linguistic features in Indo-European languages that are pre-Indo-Aryan or even pre-Indo-Iranian. So they should not be found in India, because only Indo-Iranians came to India. How can the earlier features be found in India? But they are found in India, and they are found to the east of the Rigvedic area, within India rather than to in the distant west. So which shows that the earlier linguistic phases before Indo-Iranian were not somewhere in the steppes, they were in the interior of India. For example, Proto-Indo-European has a distinction between R and L. For example, Surya for sun. In Greek, it is Helios. So H, S becomes H. So it is Helios, sort of. And R, they have L, whereas we have R. And many branches have L. So it is claimed that L is the original form, which has changed to R in Sanskrit and Iranian. Now, surprisingly, Vedic, Avestan and Mitanni all have only R. And whatever L is there in Rigvedic, Avestan and Mitanni have only R sound. They don't have L sound at all in their languages. Whereas in Vedic, L has come. But all the linguists have said this L came from dialects spoken to the east, which preserved that original RL difference. Now, since neither the Rigveda nor the Avesta nor the Mitanni preserved that distinction earlier, how could people to the east have preserved that distinction, which must be far to the west, right? It should be in the steppes, a distinction which they left, which they stopped following after they came east. So again, everything which is pre-Indo-Iranian, you find many things to the east, not to the west. Then this Norman made a study of words where he found that there are many words in the eastern dialect in North India which are not found in Sanskrit and which cannot have been derived from Sanskrit, and they have direct equivalent in Indo-European languages other than Sanskrit, that is Western Indo-European languages. In this, similarly, many words in Sinhalese show forms which are closer to other branches rather than to Sanskrit. For example, the Sinhalese word vatura for water, English water, Hittite vatar, whereas in Sanskrit it is udar, udan or udak or uda. The R is not there in it. So this is a pre shows closer affinity to them, the Western languages. Although Sinhalese is right to the south of India. Now, I forgot to mention actually in this paper, there is the Bangani language spoken in Uttarakhand, which there was a big controversy some 30 years ago after some linguists discovered that it represented a Kentum language. Kentum languages are found only in the West, in Europe. And only the Satem languages are supposed to have come east. But there is a Kentum language, that Bangani, spoken in Uttarakhand. After that, the Tokharian language was discovered to the north of India, which was also Kentum. So you see, you find all these pre-Indo-European, pre-Indo-Iranian things in the east, which goes against the AIT, but supports the out-of-India theory. There are many other significant pieces of linguistic evidence for the OIT and against the AIT. And they have been cited in my books and articles. Then Nicholas Kazanath's writings on Indo-European linguistics are important because he has done very great research in that. Also in the writings of Koenraad Elst and some others. The linguistic evidence for the out-of-India theory is solid, fact-based and logical and cannot be refuted. For example, the four stages of decimal numbers, how will you refute it? It's a fact. If you examine those languages, you'll see that they are in those stages. And all the points that are mentioned now, they are all factual. You cannot refute them. Whereas the linguistic arguments for the Aryan invasion theory are all wishful, speculative, naive, and based on special pleading. When you say, but why does it prove the AIT? No, it does. You have to accept it. That professor has said it. That is the kind of argument. So they can be easily refuted, those arguments. So the OIT case is now irrefutable, whether anyone likes my use of that word or not. You know, in all my books and articles, I write that irrefutable. So many people say, how can you use such a word? What does he think of himself? But it's true. Whether you like it or not, it is irrefutable. No one can refute it. And the but the political dice is loaded against the out of India theory. So although it has actually won on logical ground, in practically it is not a dead horse, as I said. So what next? The scholars doing research on the OIT can only continue doing their work, finding newer and newer evidence, answering objections and queries, and easily refuting new AIT arguments, which can only be as flimsy as the older ones. Beyond that, we can only hope that the political dice become slightly less loaded against us, which is a very big hope indeed. I don't have that hope. And secondly, that the AIT side makes the big mistake of daring to take on the OIT side in debate, which they are avoiding. If someone among them makes this mistake, they will lose the debate, and then that will end the matter for them. But again, this is a very big hope, because they know that fools rush in where angels fear to tread. So they will never tread into this such debate. So beyond continuing to work and to hope, that is little we can do.
So now, with that really, really, you know, insightful presentation, and what you've said in the end makes so much sense, that we have to keep doing and we have to keep pushing the political dice in our favor. So now I'll quickly go to Dr. Koenraad Elst so that he can move this conversation forward and ask his very relevant questions to Shrikantji.
Yeah, so I greatly enjoyed not just the contents of what you said, which by now I'm rather familiar with, especially the fire with which you said it. Very good. Now, I've also been listening to what Tanya just said, that she herself came to not feel at home in India because of the Aryan invasion theory. So that's the effect that it apparently has on native Indians. Now, imagine the absurdity of this. You see, here there are people who are told not to feel at home in India because their ancestors have been there for only 4,000 years. See, I mean, even if this was true, you see, it is quite absurd in international terms. Imagine how many Americans would not be legitimate Americans if their ancestors were only there for 3,000 years. So the whole situation that we are up against is very bizarre. And so some people in the West who don't understand the situation think that the out of India theory is very politicized, not realizing that the most politicized historical theory in world history is precisely their own Aryan invasion theory, which wreaks havoc, which works havoc in India already since independence or since before. Anyway, so there's more absurdity here. The whole absurdity of the debating situation, actually, the evidence that you have developed has been accumulating so much, and yet the professionals remain deaf. So here's my first question to you. So you have said correctly that the out of India theory is an orphan, whereas the Aryan invasion theory has the support of the entire academic establishment, and also the political support of the Nehruvians, Ambedkarites, the Refutationists, the missionaries, and in fact, in a passive, inertial sense, even by the present so-called Hindu nationalist government. like just now, Prime Minister Modi has again reiterated the use of the word Adivasi, which is a one-word propaganda term that tells all the non-tribals that they are illegitimately in India, that they are invaders. Right. Now, while the enemy side is very determined in upholding the Aryan invasion theory and throwing the consequences of that theory in your face regularly, very few people on the Hindu side seem motivated. There's really only a handful of people who carry the flag of the out of India theory. So how come people around you are so lukewarm, so unmotivated?
I think most of it I spoke in this, that there are many large sections of Hindus, very large sections, who have certain obsessions and they are concerned with those obsessions, whether of chronology, of divine revelation, or whatever, of the, you know, Vedic being the fountainhead, etc., etc. And since my OIT theory does not pander to all those things, many of the people who are actually strongly Hindu, they are not really my supporters. And those who are my supporters, they are, I'm sure, active on social media. But as I said, the number is small. And if I, with my books, cannot do anything, what will those people do? And as I said, see, if ultimately we can all talk about it, not lukewarmly, but very strongly and this thing. But what will be the effect if those people up don't do anything about it? And as I said before in one talk, when such a question was asked about why OIT is not being supported, well, we all know two sadhus were killed in Palghar and created such a furor all over the country. Who bothered about them? So why will they bother about the out of India theory? You see, certain things are very important. When elections come up, they take up those issues and suddenly become passionate supporters of such issues. Those who can do things, I'm talking about, not the people on the internet. Now, these people become very strong supporters of those issues. And once the election is over, they stop, they forget them. Now, this Aryan invasion theory is not even an issue you can raise in elections. So why will anyone bother about it? So I there's no question of supporters being lukewarm. The thing is that, as I said, the dice is loaded against us. If I can't do anything, what will any supporter do?
Is it not bizarre that those pontificating against the Aryan invasion theory, that they never sit down to devise a winning strategy? You see, they apparently maybe are so insular that they don't care about what the rest of the world says. At any rate, no one seems to have remarked publicly that, in spite of all this evidence, we are not making any headway. You see, is nobody concerned to devise some kind of winning strategy? Don't they feel concerned that this seemingly is not going anywhere?
See, winning strategies are being devised because Indians are very, quite expert in many fields. So they do devise winning strategies. But those winning strategies are for making money, expanding businesses, winning elections, not for fighting for intellectual issues, unfortunately. And those few who are doing it, as I said, that is why I said we should continue doing our work and hope. So work and hope are the only two things that we can do. You know, anyone who has an animal farm will know that most Hindus fall in the category of the horse in that, who also has two slogans, not work and hope, but the leader is always right. Means leader, I'm not referring to any particular person. All those who are leaders, they are always right. And second, I will work harder in the service of those leaders, not for such causes. So we can do our work. We cannot, I don't know how we can make people more aware. I have no idea. And yes, as you said, many people remark that for the more evidence you put out, it makes no change and all. We have seen many people, those are the same supporters whom you have referred to as UCOM. They also raise this point, but who will listen? That is the point.
Now, about the other camp, about the Aryan invasion camp, you spoke about the vested interests that keep people supporting the Aryan invasion theory. Could you throw some more light on the different motives that may be at play there?
Yeah, see, the vested interest means obviously there are, as you pointed out, the missionary group, the other groups of that kind who are anti-Hindu or against India, who don't want India to rise as a civilization again. They are against it, of course. But other vested interests are, you know, caste groups within India. And they may be calling themselves Dalit groups, for example, and fighting in the name of being the oppressed natives of India who are invaded and, you know, harassed and tortured by the invading Aryans. Surprisingly, the person whom they consider their spiritual guru, Dr. Ambedkar, was the one who had strongly opposed this Aryan invasion theory. At a time when, you know, people like Lokmanya Tilak were promoting the theory strongly, Dr. Ambedkar had strongly opposed it. And yet, those people talking in his name, they associate caste and race and they talk about this Aryan invasion theory. At the same time, there is that other group. Like as I said, Lokmanya Tilak was there, but his heritage is being still carried forward by many groups of Brahmins all over India who feel that they belong to a superior Aryan race and they are not, you know, belong to the riffraff of lower caste people. They are separate. They identify with the West. And so these Brahmin groups are strong supporters of AIT. And they are not anti-Hindu groups, let me tell you. They are very staunchly Hindu groups who are pro-AIT. They are pro-AIT, AIT and anti-OIT as Hindus. And then there is that other group among them. Many of them, you know, have studied in Western universities, in Western texts. As Tanyaji pointed out, how her text influenced her thinking. So these people also have that same thinking. So even if they think as Hindus, they don't dare to think that those Western scholars whom they revere so much could have been wrong. And then of course there are those scholars, Western scholars who may be, many of them may be genuine scholars also, but they have been writing since so many years on a certain thing. Now how can you expect them to say, most scholars don't have a big heart like B.B. Lal to say, yes, I was wrong and now I'm going to say the right thing. So these are all the different vested interests.
One lack that existed in the out of India so far, at least that was my impression, is the lack of archaeological evidence of a trail of emigrants starting from India and going through Central Asia. You see, in the other direction, of course, we do note the absence of any evidence for the Aryan invasion. But on our side, we were not doing much better in the sense that we still had no evidence for the counter movement, for the emigration from India. However, I note with satisfaction during your lecture that, like myself, you also seem to be quite happy with the recent presentations by Dr. Alexander Semenenko, who has made it his business, not just in other fields like matching Vedic literary data with Harappan archaeological data, but also specifically here to map out actual archaeological evidence for a movement from India into Central Asia and even beyond. So I suppose we are in agreement, and so please say your own impressions about this, but I suppose we are in agreement in thinking that we are now witnessing another big step forward, one that we can thank Dr. Semenenko for.
Yeah, exactly. As I said, Semenenko's paper, and he's doing a primary work in this field. And I hope many other scholars will follow in that line. But nevertheless, as I said, it is especially commendable because, as I said, you will rarely find archaeological evidence at the starting point. Like, for example, what archaeological evidence will you find in Europe that the Europeans went to America, migrated to America? You will find archaeological evidence of people who went to America then came back bringing, say, American artifacts, American plants, American animals with them. But they are people who came back. But if they had not come back, what evidence would there have been? So you see, it is very difficult. And in the face of that, the start that has been made by Alexander Semenenko is very commendable.
Shrikant sir, actually, you know, it's even I've been researching into history and heritage of our country. And particularly my focus area has been, you know, the Jaina history and heritage. Jaina and the Shramana. Now, obviously, this particular subject of Aryan invasion theory keeps coming up. And they have been, you know, so I've been going through the details. What I want to share with you, and probably, you know, then you can respond to it. The more back we are actually gone to the Jaina heritage, or the alternate, you know, the other term for Jaina heritage is the Shraman heritage. So in the Shramana heritage, 2000 years before, what is actually being claimed as per the Shastra and as per all the evidence, that somewhere in, you know, if we can go to the Harappan era, there was a big, you know, attack on the Shramana tradition, and there was a big decline of Shramana tradition to the current stage, right, we are. Now, that particular destruction actually led to, you can say, how should I say? For example, if you go to the entire southern part, you'll find thousands and thousands of Jaina heritage all across the South India. It's there all across the India, particularly in the southern, you know, the Dakshin Bharat. But somewhere you will find that the population, the quantity and the followers of Shramana tradition, in South they actually call it Samana, is hardly there. Only Karnataka can boast of a sizable number of, you know, the Jains. Elsewhere in Tamil Nadu, in Kerala, and the entire Dakshin Bharat, you won't find Jains, but you will find the Jaina heritage in huge quantity. And in Jaina heritage, we call them, you know, the Dravidian architecture. That's a term which is actually used in, you know, the Jain Shastra. Now, I'm not using the word Aryan invasion. Even in the chat box, I've written a particular shloka which is used in all the Vedic, even in Hindu, even in Jain. We use that particular shloka to call the, you know, the puja start karte. That time, that shloka is there. And even there also, the term Arya is there. But that Arya meaning is something else. So, there was a big damage to the Shraman tradition. That is absolutely sure. There is no doubt about it. Now, who did it? Were they the native, the homegrown people, and then they went outside, or they came from outside, settled here? I'm not going to term them anything, but what my research is reflecting is that something happened, destruction absolutely happened. A lot of these people who were following Shramana tradition, they went all across the country, okay? And that time, the geographical area of the Bharat was very big. You're already aware of it. So this is where that they, so this particular, you know, like the Sunoli excavation which came up. So there it came that something happened and a lot of shamanic tradition was harmed during that particular, in the, that particular stage. So something happened. Now who did it? So that's still, you know, I'm still researching, still exploring into that subject. So this is what I actually wanted to share.
See, what he is asking, all about Shramana tradition and history and all that is actually all not pertaining to the Vedic culture because it is completely different. It's to the East. And as I have pointed out, most historians would say this is all post-Vedic culture which developed in the East. But I have pointed out that it is not. All these, the Vedic culture was the culture of the Purus. But to the East were the Ikshvakus and others. And they also had their own culture. And Jain and Buddhist traditions go back probably as far back. I don't mean starting with the Buddha, but whatever traditions were carried on by the Buddha and by Mahavir, they go back much back further back into the past, probably as far back as the Vedic period. But they have no connection with the Vedic period directly. They are the cultures of the East. Like even in the Vedic literature, you will see that the culture was more, you know, ritual and poetry and that sort of thing. Philosophy had a very small play part in Vedic culture. And it comes to a peak during the Upanishadic period, where there were all kinds of philosophical discussions and all. And they took place in the East, in Bihar and Eastern UP. If you see, like in the court of King Janaka, people are discussing things, etc. So you see, what we see is that different parts of India contributed in different ways to Indian culture. So while we got the Vedic culture from the West, Punjab and Northwest, and Haryana and Western Uttar Pradesh, but in the East, you had this philosophical culture. So you see Buddhism, Jainism, Charvaka, or Upanishadic philosophy, all the, you know, philosophical streams were from the East. And they are as old as the Vedic, only they entered into the literary field after the Vedas. It's like, you know, the Andamanese languages have been there since 60,000 years. But the first written record of it is when some British scholars noted it down in a book. So you can't say Andamanese language came into existence when that book was written. So Jainism, these Eastern traditions were also there all the time. Only they were recorded at a later date after the Vedic.
Namaste, Shrikant sir. My question is, in colonial times, Aryan invasion theory or whole Aryan invasion debate is linked with racism, like racist theory, all kind of. But after World War II, the racist theories, all type of this racist thing ended. But now in current times, this AIT debate, whole AIT or Aryan invasion debate is linked with the genetics, the haplographs and these things and this thing. Do you find any parallel between colonial times racism theories about AIT and current genetics studies with linked with AIT?
Well, see, as Conrad has pointed out many times, the earliest theory of Aryan origin was the out-of-India theory. That is, before this thought of this Steppes and all those other theories, they had the European scholars believed that India was the homeland. Later, it shifted westward. So you see, there are things which are repeating itself now, but with different connotations. Like, first they used to discuss about Aryans being pure, like, you know, blonde Aryans with blue eyes and tall, with dolichocephalic heads and that sort of thing. But Max Miller completely rejected this. He said, Aryan is only about language and only about language and nothing else. Nothing about blood, bones, hair, eyes, etc. Unfortunately, now that the Aryan invasion theory has lost ground in the fields of textual analysis, linguistic arguments, and archaeology. So now they're trying to revive that, you know, genetic, racial kind of, in very, very much modern terms, which they will say has nothing to do with what the earlier racists used to talk about. But ultimately it boils down to that, unfortunately. And it, again, they forget what Max Miller had pointed out, that it is a question of language, not of any kind of racial or, you know, ethnic element, physical element.